Good morning. From Zephaniah chapter 3 says, "The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing." We're beginning our service this morning thinking about God's love, about how very much he loves us. This would be a great way to start every morning if you could just sing this little chorus when you get up in the morning and just think about how much God loves us. Let's stand together as we sing, "Think About His Love."
My God, my Savior has left.
Pray with me. Father, thank you for your mercy and your grace. Thank you for your amazing love for us. In response to thinking about your love this morning, we give ourselves to you. We give you our worship and praise, our love. You gave your all for us and your Son Jesus, all because you loved us so much. And we rejoice in your salvation. Thank you for our time together this morning, for our church family that is gathered here, and for those who are not able to be here today. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for your good singing this morning. I'd like to invite our children to come down the front for the children's sermon. While they're doing that, would you take a moment to greet those around you and then join us in a song at Calvary?
That's a great one. I'm delighted to welcome you to worship today. And if you're our guest, we are thrilled that you have come here and decided to spend this time with us. You are welcome here. And the only thing we ask is that you would fill out the fly leaf in your worship bulletin and put it in the offering plate as it passes. Our gospel reading today is in the Gospel of Luke, this marvelous story of the prodigal son and the loving father and the older brother. I think all of us will find some place in that marvelous story that God will speak to us. Miss Susan has our children's message today, and she's got the kiddos.
Right, 40 days, that's leading up to Easter, and we've talked about that before. So one of our scripture passages for today that we're reading is found in the book of Psalms, Psalm 32, in the New Testament, right? New Testament? Oh my goodness, the Old Testament is where we find Psalms. So, you failed the test, I'm sorry. I thought that I would use some scrambled letters in order to help us understand Psalms 32 in the Old Testament a little bit better, okay? You didn't know I was going to ask you that, did you? All right, so look at this real quick. What is this? Sin, right? Okay, so what is sin? Just tell me. You do something wrong, or we don't do something we know we should do, right? That's what sin is. When we don't do something God wants us to do. All right, so in verse 5 of Psalms 32, it says, I confess all my sins to you. I do not try to hide them. All right, so keep that in mind. The next word is this. Oh, y'all are good. Forgive. So what does it mean to forgive? Like, you feel bad for someone or something you've done, you feel bad. Right, you're giving them a second chance, right? So in verse 5 of 32, it says, you forgive me all of my guilt. My sin is gone. All right? So what's this one real quick? Yeah, that one's pretty easy. In John 3:16, it says, for God so loved the world, his only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish. Right, okay. So what is this one? Oh, good. Relationship. So there we go. All right. So, because of Jesus and what he did for us on the cross, right, we can have that one-on-one relationship with God, our Heavenly Father, right? And we want to do things that please God, right? We want to have loving actions and deeds toward others, and we want to use kind words, right? Always being kind, so pretty simple. So in verses 11, it says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. God's promise. And the last one is joy. I know, I gave them first shot. So in verse 11, it says, so rejoice in the Lord and be glad. Be thankful for what he has done. Shout for joy and celebrate God. So the passage in Psalm 32 says to me that we've all sinned. God knows it. We can't hide it. We might as well go ahead and confess it or say it out loud, right? Through Jesus, God gives us an opportunity to be forgiven, right? So that we can have that relationship with God, our Heavenly Father. And because of that relationship, it should cause us to have what? Great joy, and to want to celebrate God for what all he has done for us. So let's pray. Thank you, God, for this day, and thank you for your blessings you've already given us. Father, help us to always be watching for how you are blessing us and working in our lives. Father, in this season of Lent, we continue to be grateful for what you gave to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, help us to be willing to admit that we've sinned, to ask you for forgiveness, and to develop that special relationship with you so that in our hearts and in our minds and in our actions, we will try to do things that will be pleasing to you. We love you and we celebrate you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. Yeah. Despite the drop in the temperature outside, it is certainly a lovely day, and it's great to be together with everyone today. And so I get the privilege of just drawing our attention to just a few things that will be happening in the life of the church this week. And I hope that you will make plans to take part in some of these things. But as all of us are aware, and probably some of us more than others, our students are actually on spring break this week. So Wednesday, April 3rd, from 12 to 4 p.m., our youth are going to go, and we're going to have a missions day, and we're going to be partnering with Butchell Park Baptist Church and maybe a few others if there are any takers. But we're going to meet up for lunch, and then we're going to go over to Kentucky Refugee Ministries, and we're going to volunteer in their warehouse for a few hours, and then we'll just come back here and be here for the evening activities. So I hope that we will make plans to take part in that this week. And we still have two more of our Lenten Friday prayer services. These we're meeting in here in the sanctuary from 12 to 12:30 on those Fridays. And this week's prayer service will be led by Blair Close. So come and join us if you haven't made it yet, and you have some time available. I promise it will be a blessing. And then this Wednesday night's dinner is Chick-fil-A night. So who doesn't like Chick-fil-A, right? I mean, so if you have not made a reservation, you want to do so to make sure that there's a sandwich for you. And then plan to stay for the other activities that are taking place on Wednesday night. But, you know, clearly this is not all of the things that are going on in the life of the church. And so for a complete list of everything that's coming up, be sure to look on the inside of your bulletin. And you'll see some other important dates that are getting ready to come up on us. But let's return to our time of worship now as Barbara Razor comes and shares some scripture with us.
This is a reading from Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For night and day, your hand was heavy on me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. And all God's people say,
receive forgiveness from God by being washed in his blood. This is our offertory hymn this morning, and let's stand together as we sing.
Are you washed?
deacons to now come to receive this morning's offering. Our offering is our response to God's love and mercy in our lives. As Barbara read that wonderful passage of Scripture about God's forgiveness, we respond to His forgiveness with our gratitude. Who has our offering, our prayer? Ray? Brother Ray Walters comes to ask God's blessing on this morning's offering.
Father, we come this morning to return a portion of what Thou abundantly has given us. Dear Father, may be it used to own glory of Thy kingdom, and may in our hearts be cheerful givers, because we know, Lord, that You love a cheerful giver. Ask this in Thy name, amen. Thank you.
Loving Father, one of the sweetest privileges of knowing you is to be known by you, to be cared for, to be heard. And it is our great privilege to bring to you these prayers for our friends and family members and for ourselves. We ask, O God, for healing, recovery, for renewed strength for those who are ill. We ask, O God, for direction for those who are seeking your will for their lives. We ask for reunion for those who are separated by miles or by a broken relationship. And we ask you to renew us. Return to us the joy of your salvation. Our Father, we lift all of these prayers, spoken and unspoken, to you. As we join with one voice the model prayer that our Lord Himself gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to the fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And so they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never even gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home. You kill the fattened calf for him.' My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." This is the word of the Lord.
And made me what I There is a man with two sons. There's an older son and a younger son. He asked for money, and I want my share of your money.
So he ran away, and his dad was just waiting on the porch, waiting for him to come back.
Then he was having good times going to parties and stuff.
Buy expensive clothes, eat expensive food.
He spent all his money and he was poor. So the only thing he can work for is feeding pigs.
He was so hungry that he ate the pig food.
He tries some of the pig food and then he slinks.
What am I doing? He knew what was right to come back home.
He thought that his father would be angry with him.
He was just waiting at his porch for him to come back.
He sees him walking up the street and he runs down and gives him hugs. Hooray, my son's back. Sorry for running away. I'm glad you're home.
They invited all the townspeople over.
They had a big party. Is very pouty.
He never had a party thrown for him.
His father came to talk to him.
Why does he get a party but not me?
And he said to his son, everything that I have is yours. We thought your brother was dead, but he's alive.
Tried to cut these corners, tried to take the easy way. I kept on falling short of something.
This morning comes with a word of warning. It's directed mostly at those of us who have loved and served the Lord for a long time. If you are fairly recent to knowing the Lord, you can sit back and relax for a little while. I was saved 52 years ago in Vacation Bible School. And in September of that fall, I was baptized in a creek outside the little country town. I preached my first sermon at the age of 12, and I'm so grateful there are no recordings of that. At 15, I was the preacher for children's church every Sunday for a couple of years until I went away to school. I spent 13 years after high school going to school. My parents were sure I couldn't come up with a better idea. And all of those years were spent in a religious school pursuing religious studies. Here's the problem. If this religion thing doesn't work out, I'm really in trouble. I think I did learn I can sell concrete statuary if I had to, but that's a story for another day. By all standards in this scripture passage, I am the older brother, and that's not really a good thing. I have all the credentials it takes to be a Pharisee in this story. By Luke chapter 15, the crucifixion is looming. It's just a short few chapters ahead. Jesus' enemies were the older brothers. They were the Pharisees and the scribes. Those men who had dedicated their lives to studying the Bible. They were educated professionals of religion. From childhood, they had read and studied the Old Testament. And they were determined to keep the law as best as they possibly could. They were showing God how much they loved him by radical obedience to the rules. Now, I want you to hang on to that because it's going to come back around in just a few minutes. They demonstrated their love for God by being obedient to the rules. And it didn't matter to them if it brought them joy or pain. It was their job, and they were going to do it. But here was the problem that they had. Jesus was not following the rules. The rules said, do not sit down at a dinner table with rule breakers. Like people who sell sex for a living. Don't have anything to do with them. People who work for the Roman army. Don't talk to them. Don't touch them. Avoid them. But Jesus is doing exactly that. He's eating with tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes. He's laughing and telling jokes. He's acting like he likes them. Like maybe they are human beings. And not invisible to his eyes. And he actually knows their names. And Jesus hears his enemies in what we would call a stage whisper. Murmur, 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 murmur. So he decided to tell three stories. The first story was a man who had 100 sheep. And he lost one of his sheep, and he left the 99 sheep, and he went looking until he found the 100th. And when he found the 100th sheep, he brought it back, and he had a party, and he roasted that sheep. No, that's not the story. That would be, he had a party, and he celebrated, and he invited his friends, and said, I have found my lost sheep. And then he said there was a woman who her whole life savings was 10 coins. And she lost one of those coins, and so she got her broom out, hoping that she could sweep and hear the coin on the stone floor. And then got a light, got a candle or a lamp, and got down in the cracks. Maybe it had fallen down in the cracks. And when she found that 100th, that 10th coin, she called all of her neighbors together, and she had a party. This is an ouch moment for the Pharisees and the scribes. Because they had been showing God how much they love him by keeping the rules. And now it says that when one sinner repents, God dances across heaven. Pharisees say, I've never been lost. So what's God done for me? I want you to see the progression here. 100 sheep, and God cares for 1 out of 100. 10 coins, and God cares for 1 out of 10. 2 sons. How much more does God care for that one? A wealthy man had only 2 sons. And according to Deuteronomy chapter 21, the oldest son gets a double portion. So in this case, 2/3 of this father's sizable estate goes to the older son. Now, here's the way it works. Like in our world, you really don't get it until dad's dead. And so when the younger son asks for his third, it's almost like the son is saying, I wish you were dead. Probably in our ears, we don't hear the disrespect that the early listeners would have heard. He takes his third of the estate and he blows it. It's the older brother who later tells us exactly what he did with it. He was having parties with prostitutes. The Bible says he squandered it, his wealth, in wild living. I'll let your imagination go wild. No respect for what his father had given him or how his father had earned the money. The lessons he was taught or the responsibility that had been drilled into his head since childhood, he blew it all. And as luck would have it, it coincided with a famine and an economic depression, so that no one had anything to share with him. He had no funds. He had no friends. He had no options. He had left everyone and everything. And so a Jewish boy got a job feeding pigs. I wonder if that caused a gasp to these Pharisees and scribes. In other words, he was living among the Gentiles, not even among his own people. And he was so hungry that he ate the pods, the carob pods. You've seen carob. It comes in a sticky pod. And in times of great famine, people would cook and eat these pods. In fact, one rabbi said carob pods had turned more people back to God than anything else. But you don't cook them when you feed them to the pigs. You just feed them raw. And that's what he's eating. And in one of those, maybe one of the greatest lines in the New Testament, while he's down eating the food that he's serving the pigs, he came to himself. I just think that's powerful. He came to himself. He understood, maybe for the first time, who he was and what he'd done and where he'd been and what his future looked like. And he figured out then, in that moment when he came to himself, that he had only himself to blame. I think it's a very mature statement. That point in life when we come to ourselves and realize everything I have done, I've done to myself. It's not my parents' fault, not the church's fault, not the school's fault. Perhaps that is the mark of true maturity. I've hurt people. I've thrown opportunities away. I've done damage to my own body. And he had nothing left to do but go home, because he remembered that even his father's hired servants had better food than uncooked carob pods. And as he's walking up to the house, in one of the great scenes in Jesus' stories, can't you see the father waiting on the porch? And rather than waiting for the boy to come home, the father runs to meet him. And almost before the boy can blurt out his confession, his father is calling for servants. Bring a ring. Restore him to the family. Bring some shoes. Because slaves don't wear shoes, but my children wear shoes. Bring a robe. He's cold. Bring him back into the family. And I want you to notice in this story of Jesus, there's no sermon to the boy. There's no long and involved acts of penance, things he has to do in order to get back into the family, 3-month probation, you need to submit a budget for the next 3 months, and nothing like that at all. The father says, this is my son who was dead and is alive. was lost and is found, and Dad throws the best party the county had seen for a long time. Not just a calf, the fattened calf, the one who had been specially grain-fed for this occasion, we would say veal chops. It's extravagant, and everybody is invited, and there's singing, and there's dancing, and there's music, and it is such a great party that out in the field, the older brother hears the music. And as he comes near the house, he says, "What's going on? Your brother is home, and your father is throwing him the best party." Let's stop to think about this father for a minute. There is no guarantee the boy won't take off again. There's no compensation for what was lost. Just extravagant love. The younger son in no way could have understood the father's love for him until he experienced it. But remember, I said that this sermon is for us older brothers in the room. And so far, it's just love, love, love everywhere. But when the older brother gets to the house, he refuses to go in. It was an act of arrogance and disrespect. And early hearers of the story, the Jewish hearers, would have expected the father to go out and given him what for. My grandmother used to say, he would go out and show him how the cow ate the cabbage. I don't know what that meant, but I understand what that means. Because surely the father would go out and give this older boy a talking to. Because as soon as the father goes out, the older brother says, "All these years, I have worked like a slave. All these years, I've never had a party. All of these years, I've followed the rules. I've been the responsible one. I've played my part. I have demonstrated my obedience by following the rules." And the Pharisees and the attorneys of the Bible who were there did not miss the point, I can assure you. And neither should we. The older brother had not yet come to himself. Yeah. He owned the rest of the estate. He inherited a farm and servants and livestock, but he did not earn them. He followed the rules, but the estate was not his because he followed the rules. The estate was his because they were gifts from his loving father. They were not there because he was obedient. They were there because his father loved him. The older brother forgot the joy of loving and being loved and instead swallowed the bitter pill of self-righteousness. He convinced himself that everything he had, the estate and all of the livestock and the servants, that he had earned, where the younger son had experienced grace and mercy. What the older brother had not yet come to see is that the grace and mercy lavished on the younger son had also been lavished on him, and yet he had not yet come to see it. He had insisted on proving his love all the time by his obedience to the rules, when all along the father asked him to prove his obedience by love. That's the point of the sermon, so I'm going to say that again. He had insisted on proving his love by his obedience, when all along the father asked him to prove his obedience by his love. I think you're seeing the point. I hope you're seeing the point. May we never forget that we did nothing to earn God's love. I don't care how many passages I declined in Greek, how many nights I stayed up all night typing papers, probably because I played too much during the day. But I never earned God's love. And neither can you. So here's what we older brothers can do. We come to ourselves. We come clean with who we are and what we do, and what we deserve. And we come to the party in the house and join others who live by that same principle. That who we are is not because of our own obedience, but because of the love and mercy and grace of a loving Father. If he cared for 1 out of 100, and 1 out of 10, and 1 out of 2, how much more does he care for you, who are a unique and wonderfully made individual? So if you read the bulletin, the sermon title is, "So What You Gonna Do About It?" What you gonna do about it? Are you going to choose to love extravagantly like God does? Are you going to choose to invite into the party like God invites into the party? And when are you going to start doing that? This is the season of Lent, of repentance, of self-examination. You can try to prove your obedience by following the rules. But I would recommend that you'd follow the message of Jesus, and that you prove your obedience by loving extravagantly as God loves. Pray with me. Oh Lord, we who have served you a long time, we're grateful for those years we've walked with you, for the beautiful moments that have been so intimate. We're grateful that you protected us from making some decisions that would have been so harmful to ourselves or to someone else. And for those times we made those wrong decisions, thank you for restoring us. Remind us, O God, of your extravagant love, that all of those kind deeds, all of those good things we did, were because we loved you, not in order to earn the grace you show us. And so, Lord Jesus, we hear this story and we come to ourselves to say, we want to love like you love. To forgive like you forgive. To be open like like you are open. We join our hearts with yours, O Lord, as you remake us in your image. As we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our service today ends with an invitation to you to publicly profess your faith in Christ if you do not yet know the Lord Jesus. Today is the day to come home. We invite you to walk down these aisles, and I'll be right here at the front to receive you and to help you share with the church your decision to come home. We also invite you to unite with the church. Some of you are Christians already of another congregation, someplace else in the state or in the city. But we invite you to unite with us by transfer of your membership or through the water of baptism. But we also invite you today to a place of prayer. This invitation is about making decisions of all kinds. Decision to love as Jesus loves. We're going to stand and sing a hymn, and that's the moment to respond. I'll be waiting right here for you. Let's stand.